rainwater harvesting, reclamation, climate, a bunch of other areas. I also work in agricultural water. A lot of the same concerns there, and there a lot of times they're interrelated. We also look at money, revenue, household income, how it relates to agricultural decisions, how it relates to drinking water decisions, and the positive and negative impacts of these factors. So in India, I work on two main projects, agricultural water in Haryana and defluoridation treatment in India. And today I'm going to focus solely on the water treatment in India. The project I've been working on for the last 2 years and is the main focus of my Fulbright time here at the postdoc is from source to the user, understanding a total water approach to fluoride treatment in India. My collaborator on this project is Dr. Tanya O'Gara from the Center of Research on Environmental Decisions at Columbia University and currently at Middlesex University in London as faculty. Here in India, my host institute is NERI, the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute in Nagpur, and that's where I'm based for a year, but I've already been here for 6 months, that's just crazy, so only 6 more months, which is mind-blowing. It goes by fast, and I'm like, oh my god, there's so much stuff to do. When I talk about fluoride, I like to prime everyone as fluoride as a contaminant. Now, this is especially important in the United States where our interaction with fluoride is mainly as a beneficial additive to water to get it to a healthy range. However, fluoride is unhealthy when it is higher than 1.5. Above 1.5, you start to see the effects of dental fluorosis, and then as you get up to like 4 or 5, you can start to see skeletal fluorosis where the bones actually do not form correctly because of how fluoride interacts with the bone chemistry. In India, it is regulated, our suggested regulation of 1.5 milligrams per liter, and a lot of states have different suggestions as low as 1 milligram per liter. And it's a groundwater contaminant, so we like to say a geogenic contaminant in the water biz, but it's present worldwide in areas with the right geology. So a lot of my other work, aside from India, has focused on fluoride contamination in Western Africa and in the United States. Now, the motivation each other. So we have a lot of consistency going into this to now start to understand how does handover succeed and how does it fail and why. So again, I'm really just focusing on this user part of this whole realm. I can talk about the other ones, but focus on the user. So we approach this using social economic analysis. So our objectives here were to characterize drinking water use in villages with defluoridation treatment plans, which I'm going to, from now on, just abbreviate with DTP. Identify knowledge about the attitudes towards fluorosis, so the disease caused by fluoride, and these treatment plans. Identify economic value to villagers on the basis of fluoride-free water, so this willingness to pay, and identify the potential for these treatment plans to be managed at the community level. So what is the cooperation? Now, to address these first three, we did a contingent valuation survey, and I'll get to the fourth point later in the talk. For those of you who don't know, contingent valuation method is a survey-based method developed by environmental economists. And it says, we want to put a monetary value on something that is very hard to put a value on. Something like the environment, something like water. It evaluates social costs and benefits of projects or policies, and it identifies the price that individuals are willing to pay for non-marketed goods and services. So how do we do this? We went into our 11 villages, our sample size is 424. We made sure we were administering the survey as part of the survey. You had to be someone who was one of the primary water collectors in the household, and the survey was about 40 minutes. And we did everything on smartphones, so no paper surveys, which is awesome. If you've ever done paper surveys and transcribing, that's terrible. It's tedious work, and you can make a lot of errors there. So our survey was divided into six main components. So one component was water attitude. So we asked people, do you feel your water has, over the last 10 years, do you feel your water quality has worsened, stayed the same, or improved? How do you feel about the quality of your water? Is it good, bad, or just okay? How do you feel about the taste? Is it tasty, is it not tasty, or do you have no opinion on it? We also did fluoride and fluorosis knowledge. So we showed people pictures of individuals with dental and skeletal fluorosis and asked the respondents, have you ever seen anyone with this symptoms or with this disease? And we didn't mention the word fluoride or fluorosis until about almost the survey was ended in order to probe people's knowledge as to if they did recognize people with those symptoms, why do people have these symptoms and why is this treatment plant there? We also asked them general drinking water and general wash knowledge and characteristics. How many liters of water do you collect? Do you feel like your water is going to, general wash knowledge, such as, do you wash your hands with soap? And if they say yes, then we ask them when, and we like tick off all of the answers that they give, looking for things that we can put in a regression model, such as washing before you eat or washing before and after a toilet to see how that impacts their willingness to support a treatment plan. We also asked them specific questions on the water treatment plan themselves. Do you know that there's a treatment plan in your village? These are not large villages, but you'd be surprised at how many people did not know that there was a treatment plant there. Did you know that there was going to be a handover? Do you think it's going to be successful? And then we introduced our willingness to pay scenarios. And finally, we ended with some socioeconomic information. So, just to give you an idea about the respondent characteristics, about 56 of our respondents were female. The average age was about 37. 72% were involved in household decisions, which is interesting, and we're getting people who feel like they are at least empowered to make decisions. We asked them about how many people lived in this village all the time. With fluoride contamination and fluorosis, it takes years of ingesting fluoride before you manifest any of the symptoms. So, always being a resident in the village was something that was really important and could also promote your willingness to participate or cooperate. 66% income was about 4,000 rupees. 66% of people own a television. 66% of people own a television. 35% of households have latrines on premises. So there is definitely, I know owning a television and a latrine are different cost expenses, but those are kind of interesting statistics for us. About half of the population have ever used it, either regularly or on occasion. So that means either on a weekly basis or every day. And the average household distance from the treatment plant was not far. So we're looking at people who are pretty much clustered around the treatment plant within the villages, but still there's some education lacking in who actually knows it's there. And only 31% had ever seen dental or skeletal fluorosis. So the way we framed our willingness to pay is we didn't just ask people, how much are you going to pay for this? We framed it as this theoretical construct. So with the first scenario, we asked them, imagine that a water committee could be set up in your village to run the water treatment system. For this to happen, everyone in the village would have to make a monthly contribution. Assume the water committee was fair, honest, and responsible, which we stressed. And then we asked them, would you be willing to pay some rupees per month towards the long-term support of the treatment system? We did a similar scenario for how much would you be willing to pay per 20-liter container, so a pay-per-use type of scenario. And then finally, we did an in-kind contribution, so how much time would you be willing to contribute, or would you be willing to contribute time towards the operation and maintenance of the system? So, looking at the willingness to pay statistics from this, some things kind of jumped out at us. First, more people are willing to pay month and contribute time than to pay per container, which was kind of surprising. We really thought that people would want to pay for what they use and would be more on board with this pay per container idea, but it seemed like people more liked to almost schedule their contribution either in a weekly manner with their in-kind time contribution or their monthly contribution. We saw that the average rupees, which is close to the median amount, was 65 rupees, which is about double or more than double than the amount proposed for some districts in Maharashtra, which are getting piped water. So the government is putting in piped water in a lot of places and proposing to charge people 30 rupees a month for piped water. And we're hearing people saying that they're willing to spend about 60 to 65 rupees a month on this treatment plant, which they still have to go and fetch. Now, pay per container method, they said that they'd be willing to pay around 7 rupees per container, which is interesting, but we need to look at how this breaks down and compares to per month. So when we look at it as per day, per container, and per year, and then an average percentage of the household income, what we see is that the pay per container actually comes out to be quite a bit higher as a percentage of someone's income than a pay per month one, which is interesting, but maybe not super interesting in the sense that if we think of how much we pay for a bottle of water for 1 liter, it's about 20 rupees. So we're really, in this scenario, are people willing to pay for it as a convenience when it's there? And it seems like it follows the same type of convenience payments that we see with any kind of bottled water construct, in the sense that you're willing to pay more when you need it and you're not really thinking about it as a consistent type of source. Why should we care? So in doing all this, we're really trying to understand the drivers to support the water treatment so we can design a policy to meet the community attitudes. To dive into this further, we did some regression analysis. So we did interval regressions to identify the key set of variables from each payment scheme. So first what we did is we looked at each payment scheme separately, per month, per container, and willingness to spend time. And then we looked at each of our categories of the survey and ran regressions on those. Then we found things that kind of rose to the top as significant, pulled those out, and ran it across all three models. So in the end, we ended up with 32 variables, including 10 village dummy variables to account for village effects. So just to show you some of the most significant ones, and just focusing on the willingness to pay per month and willingness to pay per container, because this willingness to spend time drivers were really similar to those of the willingness to pay per month. So when we look at this, we see that there are three variables or three characteristics that are motivators in both payment scenarios. Village tenure was important. Village tenure was one of the only one that was important across all three. We also see something like child ratio, where you're willing to pay more per month if you have a lot of children in your home, and not as much per container. Actually, it's decreasing pay per container, where it kind of suggests that people are scheduling their finances a little bit more when you have larger household, potentially larger set of expenses that you're thinking about. Income, even though it looks like zero, is actually positive, 0.0001, I believe, in most cases. But it is positively correlated. So the more money people have, the more money, in theory, they are willing to contribute to the water treatment plant, which lets us know at least that this is the trend we want to see, and people did understand the scenario. But we can break this down and just look at, okay, what were positive drivers and what were negative drivers for both of these scenarios. And anything that's bolded are things that were highly significant. So highly significant, so less than 1% in our P factor. So our positive drivers for pay per month were income, village tenure, religion, involvement in decisions in the household, how many children you have in your household, people who actually use the treatment plant, which is good to know, and people who feel that the handover is going to be successful. Again, this hints at the idea that in this pay per month, we're really asking people to schedule their lives. So it's really important to me that this is going to be a success if I'm going to pay 60 rupees per month, because if I show up on day two and it's closed, I'm going to be pretty pissed. Whereas if I'm doing pay per container, and I pay my 7 rupees one day, and I come the next day to get 20 liters, and it's closed, I'm not out any money. I may be inconvenienced, but I'm not out any money. Negative drivers, which in both cases make sense. If you feel that your water quality is already good enough, you're not going to really be willing to pay for what we're pitching as potentially better water quality. And then also, if someone has a household purification system at their home, they're less likely to pay for one that they have to go walk to. Now, when we say household purification system in our survey, this could mean someone pouring water through a cloth. But it's really the mental attitude of, I'm already treating my water at home, why do I need to do something else? None of the treatments that were being instituted in the home would treat for fluoride. It's boiling water and pouring the water through a cloth were the primary ones that we saw people doing. Okay. So again, if we understand the drivers to support water treatment, we can design a policy to meet community attitudes. So this was the first step of our research. Then we went forward and we're like, okay, so we have a little bit of an understanding as to what kind of payment scheme we could approach people with. Now, what about policy surrounding that? Because it's not so much to say, okay, we're going to implement a pay-per-month scenario and everyone's going to sign up on it and it's going to be great. We need to understand, okay, how can we now effectively design the policy for this pay-per-month scenario that will make people want to cooperate and join in, right? So we use public economic experiments called public goods games, or framed field experiments, as they're also called. How do we do this? So the way the game is played is that there are five villagers in a room, and we give them all 10 rupees at the beginning of each round. And we ask them, okay, how much are you willing to contribute to this group pot, this group account, knowing that every rupee that you contribute is going to be doubled and then distributed amongst everyone in your game here. So for example, if everyone contributed their 10 rupees, that would be doubled, redistributed, and everyone would make out with 20 rupees. However, if say these two people gave all of their money and the remaining three gave none, that'd be 20 rupees, that would be doubled, 40 rupees divided by 5, 8 rupees, they would make out with 8 rupees and the remaining three would have 18. So this really only works to everyone's benefit when everyone contributes a lot. As soon as you have a defector, we have someone who is free riding on everyone else's contribution. And this relates directly with something like public goods, like water or water treatment, a lot of these public squid games are played with irrigation water management, since if we all have straws in an aquifer and we're all sipping from it, the fact that I say, oh, I'm going to reduce my consumption is not going to decrease the depletion of the aquifer significantly. We need everyone to come together to really value it. In the same way, we can't just have one person paying for the water treatment plant, we need everyone to come together and value it. So we use these same scenarios. When we would teach people how to play the game, we went through a lot of game explanation to make sure everyone had the rules down. We did practice rounds where we played as many as 10 rounds with everyone before we started the game so that we knew that people were understanding what was going on. Because about 2% of our population had no education and not very many had high level of education. What we also did is gave them decision sheets, as we called them, where people would physically circle how many rupees they were contributing or circle the zero if they were contributing none. Because we felt that visually seeing how much you were contributing was more impactful than just writing a number. And people have done this in the past by giving out tokens, but we felt that that was kind of going to be a nightmare to try to orchestrate. So we ended up coming up with this, and it worked really well, because people could visually see, well, I'm giving this much of my pot to, or this much of my money to the group account. So the way that this is also set up is that we call session one the baseline game. So everyone plays the game as I just explained it. The key part in the baseline round is that you can't talk to anyone and all of your contributions are private. So no one knows what everyone else is giving. We give them folders, so you make your private circles, you put it in a folder, you hand it to the leader of the game. He hands it to his assistant, who's the accountant. That person enters everything into the smartphone where we're keeping all the records. They write a group account number on the board and how much everyone's getting. So when you get your money, when you get your folders back, you can know if you made money or lost money. Okay? After 10 rounds, we took a break. And then we implemented treatments. And the way that we did our treatments is we had 2 communication treatments, 2 social interventions, and 2 psychological interventions. After we played another 10 rounds. After 20 rounds were completed, we did an exit survey. Okay, so communication treatments. The first one is that in between each round of play, you can talk to each other. So for the first 10 rounds, there was no talking. We were like, no talking. We were very strict. And no one could talk to each other. No one could even really look at each other. Then we institute communication. You can relax more. You can talk to your partner or your neighbor in the room. What this means is that it's really imitating how people live their lives. You're not in a bubble, you talk to your neighbors. Knowing something about your neighbor or even interacting with someone in the room can help promote some cooperation or change your cooperation. However, this is pretty much taken to be a control on the whole thing, on the whole experiment, because this is how we live our lives. We interact with people. So, the other communication treatment was negotiation. So like before, you can talk to people, but now you have to talk about the game and you have to make kind of proposals about how much everyone should contribute. So we're getting people to not only just talk to each other, but to make pledges or talk about, well, I'm gonna give 5 rupees next time, so everyone should give 5 rupees, and try and propose this to the group. For our social interventions, we had 2. Public observability, so we had a board at the front of the room with each player's number, and everyone knew who was player 1, player 2, and each round of play. And we would call out player 1, how much did you contribute, and he would say 5 rupees, and we would actually write it up there. So you knew how much everyone you were playing with was contributing. This is something that is very closely related to what energy companies do in the United States currently. So if you get your energy bill in the United States, typically on it, it says how much energy you've used and how you compare to your neighbors. And what this has done is promoted conservation, because no one really wants to be seen as like the guzzler in their community, and it made it also kind of like a game in the sense that, can I reduce my energy consumption to meet my partners? And this is easily transferred. transferable into a community village scenario by physically putting up a board and putting the family names who have been contributing to the water treatment plant. Another one is leading by example. So the way that this one worked was, if I was designated the leader for this round, I would stand up and say, I'm giving 8 rupees. I'd circle my 8 rupees, give it to the person, to the leader of the group. I would sit back down, and then everyone else would make their contributions privately. So you only know how much the leader is giving. The next round, the next player in the group would do the same thing and say how much they're giving that round, and then everyone else would make their contributions privately. So that's similar to having a community organizer in the community trying to mobilize everyone and leading by example. Now, what was kind of innovative with this is we also tried to do psychological interventions by playing on people's emotions. And this is really born out of my experience in Africa, in how communication of a lot of water and sanitation topics were done in the sense that people would come in and put on plays or do some sort of dramatical reenactment of some situation in order to convey a WASH principle, a water and sanitation principle. So we looked at it two ways. We filmed a video of people playing the game that was silent, and we did two different voiceovers. So the image was the same in both of these scenarios. In the first one, our voiceover talked a lot about how I feel while I play this. If I give 10 rupees, I feel good. I'm contributing towards the community. But does this also mean that if other people don't contribute, how is that going to make me feel? Is that going to make me feel bad about my neighbor? Things like that. So playing on emotion. Without priming, it was basically math. We were describing the rules of the game in a video form. And this can also, it's a control for the emotion, but it's also really is a way to test just informational campaigns. So halfway through this whole process, and after 10 rounds, we remind people how to make money in the game by cooperating and how to do the math, right? So this is the same as the government coming in and reminding people that you should pay for your treatment plant and we should all cooperate. So we did this in 9 of our 11 villages. 2 villages had population sizes that were too small. We ended up running it a total of 45 times, 225 players, and about 4,500 rounds of play. I think it's 20 rounds of play. Okay, so we did not use the exact same people who were part of our survey. We did a random selection of people in the community. So just comparing some characteristics from our CV or contingent valuation survey to our public good game, we see that we have slightly fewer female in our public good game. Our average age is very close. We had people with higher education in our public good game because they had to have basic literacy of numbers, which we found out after piloting it. When we tried to take anyone who showed up, there were people who just did not understand it at all. So we had to have basic number literacy moving forward. So that meant that not only did we have fewer people who had no education, we had more people who had above secondary education or above primary education, and we also had a higher monthly income, which is also, I think, reflected in this literacy standard that we had. But our household sizes were about the same, and roughly about the same amount of latrines on premises, so. Okay, so here's the first 10 rounds of play. Just to orient you, we have how many rupees people contributed. Now this is for example, for our communication game, this is every person who played the communication game across the 9 villages averaged to this point for round 1, okay? So what we're seeing is an average of all of the rounds for each player who played the game. So this might look slightly different between the different treatments. However, we did 2 different statistical tests to confirm that these baseline results, even though they look like they might be varying, actually don't vary from each other. They're statistically considered the same. So that means that randomization in terms of you play treatment 1, you play treatment 2 was successful, and we don't have one group starting out either cooperating more or less. So going into our treatments, so far we're not biased. Now the average contribution for these first 10 rounds was about 4.5 rupees, 4.35 rupees. Then we implement our treatments, we take a break, we tell people the new rules, and then we start the game again. We show them videos. Okay, so the first thing that I should note is that this is very common. We see this uptick after the restarting of the play, and it's actually called the restart effect in public quiz games, and it means that everybody comes back together and everyone feels good that this is going to work again, and is more willing to contribute a little bit more, and everyone feels a little bit more generous after the break. But then we actually do a lot of our analysis past that, if it was really high, but this was kind of standard. Sorry. Two other things kind of to talk about is the fact that lead by example and our two video treatments had no effect. So what I'm going to focus on moving forward is this plummeting line here of our public observability and our negotiation one. So public observability started out, again, on the average around 4.35 and then just tanked to about 1.5 rupees by the end. Where negotiation, on average, increased the amount of people that we're going to contribute. Obviously, there's a lot of noise in that. If we played it more and more rounds, we would expect this to actually reach zero with public observability and negotiation to level out a little bit as people got better at negotiating. So I'm not going to show you go into exact detail with this, but we ran several different regressions using a random effects model. And this just, if you are into regressions, what this meant is that we could include our time invariant characteristics on the contribution. So things like income, age, and gender in our regression and assume these as significant. So we can also do dynamic effects and we can do these other stationary ones that don't necessarily change. So we also ran the regression in three ways. We ran just the treatments themselves as a model. Then, where do I go with this? Okay, if we look at that, we can see that we have two things that have an effect. Again, the mean baseline contribution for the first 10 rounds was about 4.35 rupees. But we see that we have about a 10% increase when we have negotiation as a treatment, and we have about a 37-38% decrease when we institute public observability over the course of the play. Now these two factors, they change every time we change our model slightly, but the direction and the magnitude are pretty much the same. The next thing we did is we included these dynamic variables, so learning effects of people playing the game multiple times, do they get better at it, and how does that affect it moving from baseline to treatment, and that we didn't see much difference, significant, but almost exactly significant in the same way. And then also, how does the round before, the play of the round before affect my behavior in this current round? And so it does affect, so people are reacting to how everybody else is contributing. And then finally, we did a full regression. And from this, I'll just point out what, again, were positive drivers and our negative drivers. So our positive drivers were the negotiation treatment in general. So having people negotiate terms. Income, which again we hope to see in these things, to say that if I have more money, I'm willing to spend more money. And the effects of my fellow participants the round before. So I am directly reacting to how everybody was behaving the round before. Negative drivers, public observability, tanked. Learning effects, so as I learned the game, as I went on with play, I was less likely to give money. Age, so the older I was, the less money I gave. Educational level and household size. Anything in bold was highly significant. So what does this mean? And we have been, and I'm going to probably start with this when we get to discussion, but we've been racking our brains. So this public observability model is put in so many places and does so well. Not only is it cheap to implement in the sense that you literally put a board up next to the treatment plant and write people's names on it who are paying every month to rally the community around it, it's worked in multiple different countries and in multiple different cooperation scenarios. But as you can see, it pretty much just drove participation down to the ground. So in talking with our collaborators at NERI, we have some theories right now. So the first one is seeing it as not socially approved, in the sense that if I give more, I might be someone who's trying to seek status within the community, and this is seen as negative. The other thing, which we found some literature to support, is this idea of really not wanting to be seen as the sucker. So usually, if I contribute, say, 8 rupees and everyone contributes 5 rupees, I would hang in there and continue to contribute 8 rupees in the sense that I would hope that everyone would match me, and people would feel shameful if they contributed less than the group. Here it actually has, it seems to, literature is suggesting that it has the opposite effect. If I contribute 8 rupees and people are contributing 5 or maybe even 2, I feel like the sucker instead of the good example. I feel like I've been hung out to dry and I'm foolish for contributing so much, and then I start lowering my bid and everyone starts lowering their bid because then someone else is the sucker, and that kind of spirals downward. Another theory was this idea of crowding out. So if one person is contributing a lot, then everyone says, well, I don't have to contribute, and kind of like pushes their contributions down as well. But again, this is a common policy that would not be effective in these communities at all. But we are seeing that there is potential for communal management of the water treatment plants, and interventions that might not work, again, are raising the visibilities of others' contributions and appointing a leader to motivate others. But what might work, and this is really hopeful, is participatory involvement of villagers in negotiation. The way that this is working right now is that the Gram Panchayat is supposedly managing the treatment plant, so when the handover occurred, the handover went from the company to the Gram Panchayat, and they're managing it. Of our 11 villages, 2 are actually managing it. The other 9 Gram Panchayats are not actively managing the treatment plant. And one of them is really kind of a model village right now that we're going to study a little bit more in depth. So what if, and there's issues with the handover and why the Gram Panchayat is not doing this, but if the Gram Panchayat meets monthly and then they have these village-wide meetings 4 times a year, what if we had a moderator go to these village meetings and really moderate a discussion about how much people would be willing to pay, and every 3 months or so reopen this discussion so that people feel like their voice is being heard and they're negotiating either this monthly cost or this per container cost. So, to pull it all together, again, we had some positive and negative drivers, but to translate the results, we are informing policymakers of the final results, and we have a consultation on monitoring evaluation policy review or revision. We're trying to figure that out. The exciting thing to us is, where are we going to go next? So we can write our academic papers, that's great, but we think that in order to really test what we think is happening, we have to do something called a randomized control trial. So what this means is, if you consider each of one of these blocks as a clump of villages that have a treatment plant, they do not have to geographically be near each other, but say we clump 3 villages per one of these boxes, right? So we need to have 21 villages. This is an example. So if we have 21 villages and we clump them into these 9 groups, then we can start to implement some different things. So the first thing we can do is say, okay, so what if we implement these payment schemes, saying that in 3 of our clumps, we're going to do a monthly payment, and we'll institute that. 3 of them, we're going to actually install water ATMs at the treatment plants, which are gaining in popularity without any research as to whether or not they work. Implement them in 3 of our groups, and in the control, we'll just say, okay, the Gram Panchayat continues to manage, unmanage, whatever, our treatment plan. Then we implement other policy on top of this. So it's not so much just how are people going to pay, but how are we going to try and promote people wanting to pay. Again, payment boards are probably not what we're going to do, but for now, we can implement, or overlay on top of this, 2 different policies. So we something like payment boards, where we actually physically put up a board and say how much people are paying, or these community negotiations. So send out facilitators to go to these village-wide meetings to facilitate a negotiation with the community members. And then we have controls in each one, and we have a group of villages that we don't touch, but we monitor with surveying as we would monitor everyone else. And then we can start to say, well, how is this working? This looks easy, this is a huge undertaking. So in order to do this, we need, I have to do the power calculations on it, but we need at least 30 communities, triple what we have now, that have treatment plants and communities that look the same. So things to consider are, what are the caste distributions? Is it a homogeneous mix? Is it a high-low mixing? What's the religion mixing? What's the socioeconomic makeup of each one of these villages? And make sure that when we do a random distribution, we have them distributed in all of these different groupings. So we can say that we have some homogeneous villages represented here and here and there in all of these different clumps. So this is what we see the next steps are, which is huge, and we're just starting this. But more than that, we have some, I would say, lingering questions. So one is just, and this is where I'll open it up for a larger discussion, either on questions or, you know, people can chime in. But we saw some positive drivers in both of our work, whether it be through the payment scenarios that we propose or through the policy that we can translate from the goods, public goods game. But how can we more positively impact community cooperation through policy? And kind of linked to that is, why was there such a negative effect with this public observability, since it works so well and is a cheap and low cost way that people kind of default to in a lot of places in trying to promote cooperation or support, especially water treatment? It is used a lot. And then from everyone's experience, just exploring more of this issue of negative cooperation. Are there other things that you've come across in policy that you've worked with that have had such a negative effect? I'll open it up for questions from you, but these are kind of our lingering questions as we look at this and think about how to design our randomized controlled trials and move forward and hopefully make this study turn into something that we can actually say is actionable and quantify the results.